Mesa Luciferians, Masonic Luciferians. These people worship spirits. These people are witches. These people are Satanists. These people do things that go against the Bible so much so that it's everything is inverted in their world, and they do some pretty bad stuff. Okay, we'll leave it at that and just say some pretty bad stuff. And it's really important that people get born again before the Feast of Trumpets, because Christ is coming and he's going to draw a line in the sand. And you can read more about that in Revelation 10, the Son of Man, the cloud walker coming. And he has his scroll of the names of all of his beautiful children. And we're also called the Bride of Christ. And so those who rejected him will be cut off, just like the Bible says in the parable of the fig tree. We're walking towards the end. We are wondering if we are not, in fact, at year 5,992, ready to flip over to 5,993 of 6,000 years on this Feast of Trumpets. And the last time I was in Stellarium, it was a couple months ago, but that Feast of Trumpets, I believe, is October 17th when I have time. Feels like everything's going 100 miles an hour right now, and I'm in quicksand trying to get out of it. I believe October the 17th is when that pickup window of the potentiality that you were told to watch for, be ready, born again, and be watching for your inheritance as the children of God, ready to get your glorified flesh, ready to go and marry your Christ, ready to go into the protective custody of the Lord Jesus Christ. And so much more could be said about that. People are to be ready and to be in the ark, meaning you're in Christ, right? Every time in the New Testament it says be in Christ, it's talking about you being born again in Christ. And as Noah had an ark made of gopher wood and tar, Christ fulfills that in a greater understanding of being our salvation ark that's not made of wood to the wooden literal, but is very much a metaphorical concept and a spiritual and physical thing of rebirth and you being in Christ. Colossians 3:3 tells you, you are hidden in Christ. As we see the day approaching, and we're not to forsake the gathering together of the saints, but that we are to comfort one another. Hebrews 10:25, I'm talking about here. As you see the day approaching. So the scripture tells you through the power of the Holy Spirit communicating to you through, your authorized apostles and prophets, Paul, who I think you can make a good case, wrote Hebrews 10:25, but nonetheless, you will perceive the day approaching, and day is capped, and that day is the day of judgment, the Yom Hadin, the Feast of Trumpets. Modern day Jews call it Rosh Hashanah. There is a list of about 30 different names I have on my wall, and I sit and study this stuff every single day. So I know my Feast of Trumpet stuff, and I'm a bit intense, but I'm full of information, lots of information. And the birthing pains that are setting up soon, could very well be this Feast of Trumpets, because have things gotten weird? We think so. And that will constitute that time of Jacob's trouble and a whole litany of consequences for those who chose not to get into Jesus. And she has plans for you, but then so do all of the witches. So do all of the Mother Earth witches with their little flowers and their little just us. Because they want to become gods is the end goal, but they're not going to be able to. And in fact, whoever takes that mark of the beast and yokes with the AI, the computers, the technology, the beast system, the whole thing, you will break out in horrendous sores. And so it don't matter how cute you look. You're going to be full of pussy, gross, bloody, nasty, disgusting sores that bust out all over your body. These people want to become gods. And as they want to become gods, they want to sort of control everyone. And they have been setting up for a long time. And you can kind of see these little things that they flag out to you in this coming planned destruction of the planet, really. But they don't realize that Satan is going to try to wipe all of humanity out. That's what Christ warned you in Matthew 24, that if he didn't come back at this shortened period of time, or a time that has a limit on it, 7 years, that no flesh would survive. So Christ really is the hero that comes in at the end of it, at the Feast of Atonement. And anyhow, you can kind of start to see how Hollywood has all of these witches, all of these masons, all of these horrible people, and they mean you harm. And it's not just Hollywood. That's just the pretty faces that have helped lead people into all paths of Broadway, into, you know, I don't need to go into all of that, but anything other than getting to the Lord Jesus Christ on that narrow path, and they need to make him look bad. So they do that. And they need to influence people so that they do not get their sins forgiven in Jesus is their main goal. And then Satan wants people to die in their sins so that they go camp in hell with him forever and get a big giant cosmic divorce from the Messiah. All bad things. She is just one of an entire community of 1,000 points of light that are distributed. We talk about this a lot on this channel. In government, really any area of influence, in music, in fashion, in makeup, in YouTube world, in the media, in Hollywood, in television, and they even have a Christian counterpart that is fake Christian. And so they're everywhere. And then they have fake church leaders and all of these people coming through your TV. I'm not so sure about Charles Stanley, but I haven't studied it that much. But all of these people coming through your TV that are saying, I'm the church, you need to listen to me. They're not teaching what they should be teaching half the time. And many of them are folding at this weird period of time anyhow. So all that to say that we can see the day approaching, that day coming. And we should really pay attention to what these horrible human beings have to tell us. And so she is on her Twitter page, got some kind of an album, and they communicate to you through their album, and it's never worn white. And there's a lot that could be said about this girl. But what specifically caught me was her little flower headdress. I've also seen Beyonce. These women are demon possessed, by the way, too. And they have this very, you know, Mother Earth nature, sacrificial, you're going to all get it in the end because we need to protect Mother Earth kind of vibe to them when you study that. And the world is really being set up for a massive, multi-headed problem, to keep it simple. And you're going to be flooded with debt the world over. As ubiquitous as the water on this planet is how much they're going to flood the earth through the American dollar of your worthless paper. And she's but one of the many entities out now. She's one of the many entities that has come across my awareness, as have Tom Hanks and others. We're going to have to talk about Tom Hanks a whole nother day, but there's a whole thing with Tom Hanks. And these evil people. Hold on a second. We'll get there. These people mean you harm, as I said before. And we're going to talk today about the similarity of MidSommar, I think is how it's pronounced. A very horrific horror movie, cult movie, and in it, they are flagging you out precisely what they intend to do in this coming time of Jacob's trouble, and the people that get caught in that trap are the fake Christians, so I'm trying to warn you of that. Okay, and so they are flagging you messages out through their music, through their visuals, through their symbology, through their songs, through their popularity, because these are the people that have, you know, whatever, millions of views, millions of people, all through the social media and so on and so forth. 3.5 million people watched this little 28-second thing here. And I feel like she's playing a, you know, paganistic Mother Earth representation. Not quite sure what's going on with the back, but that kind of makes me think of the blood moon eclipse scenario. Could be other things, because you do have wormwood incoming. I just don't know when it's coming. But that's in the Bible. That's just straight out in the Bible. And, you know, there are things that are heating up. And so it has always kind of been my heart's desire to reach out to the false converts to help them and to help them understand how to get born again and get into the ark of Jesus Christ that is your life. Christ is your life, the Bible says. And so the point of being here is to get your eternal life and to get into this new creation in Christ. And if you don't, you will have another opportunity if you live long enough to get into him. But these types of absolutely disgusting films where she is obviously using this flower, I'm going to call it a headdress because I don't know what else to call it, is being used to seed these little like Easter egg ideas into your mind. Another movie you might want to look into with regard to that is a movie called Focus that I can't stand. I've only ever watched a trailer, and it has Will Smith in it. And Margot something or other, Margot, I don't know, the girl that plays the Harley Quinn character in another movie with Will Smith, Suicide Squad, that girl. Oh, Margot Robbie, I think is her name. Anyhow, and Focus will expertly explain to you how they seed concepts into your consciousness without telling you. And they do it through a lot of different means and so on and so forth. This is one of them. This is one of them. And you actually don't even know that they're doing it unless somebody like a Call for an Uprising, who very well could be a social change agent, I don't know, or other people. I'm just a little channel. I'm just a mom, and I'm a Christian, and I love Jesus, and Jesus loves me. And I have noted some things, and I try to share these things. Unless somebody points it out to you, it will go right under the radar. But once somebody points it out to you and you start catching it, you're like, oh, I see it. Yes. And so you have the repetition that you can see how they speak in the symbolic language that's non-linguistic. It's patterns, it's symbols, and they'll slip in little things. And it's part of a whole psychological game. Very interesting. So I want you to listen to this 28 seconds, because she's not a bad singer. And people will glom onto this and go, that's pretty. They actually do not realize that these bloodthirsty, dark, satanic witches mean them harm. And these people have demons, and they do things that Leviticus would tell you not to do, but they do them anyhow in their rituals and their worship. And they go to this dark place, and these movies that they make that are absolutely disgusting. That was like, I think the second thing I quit doing in my sanctification after I got born again that I let go of was a lot of like horror movies and stuff like that. Cause I had just been raised in a culture where that was just something that you watched. Not even really thinking about the sixth command at all. And yet these movies are always about killing this and killing that and blah, blah, blah. And the Holy Spirit started working on my heart. And I started realizing, oh, this is wicked. And so my soul started Romans 12. My mind started getting in sync with the Bible and the Lord. Oh, you don't like murder. So I don't watch horror movie things. And I haven't for a long, long time. I'm just telling you about when I first got born again. I'm sorry, excuse me. The allergies are just outrageous, and it's raining here in my state. Excuse me. I'm sorry. Anyhow, so these people are seeding you out messages and programming people. And unless somebody points it out, you won't notice it. And it's really important to notice it, because consequences are coming for those one of these Feast of Trumpets. And you're supposed to look at it like this. It could be this year. And you better be watching for it, and you better be born again for it. And if this is the one that he comes and fulfills, just like he did Passover, unleavened bread, first fruits, and 50 days later, Pentecost, all with perfect precision for the born again, so will he also fulfill the exact Feast of Trumpets that is visually laid out for you in Revelation 12:5, which actually has the word rapture in it for a harpazo. And in the previous video I referenced about the psychological warfare, we will go in and show you some things that you might not have ever noticed about the Lord warning you about the setup and how that relates to what's happening now as we're walking towards what appears to be seeing the day approach. And if he does come this Feast of Trumpets, he's cutting off those who didn't get into him for that 7-year tribulation. Okay. And some people will repent later on, but it will be under some very grueling conditions, to put it very mildly. And she and all of her little Masonic witch friends have plans for you. And they are being weird because they want to communicate a message to you that probably most people aren't going to catch. And let's listen to this. Okay, that's enough of that. A lot could be said about that song, what she's saying about never worn white. I think it's just their paganistic way of saying that they don't want to come to Christ. And they want their paganistic Mother Earth relationship of weirdness with the Antichrist to come. But that's my conjecture about it. Now, when you go and you consider this headdress paganism thing that was introduced to everybody through this disgusting horror film called Midsommar, it gets weird quick. So I just showed you the picture of Katy Perry with the headdress, and she's sitting on the flower mountain thing, right? Which is weird because they are telling you in Katy Perry's stuff, as well as this horrible movie, absolutely disgusting movie, what's coming. And you can turn to your Bible very clearly in Revelation 6, the fifth seal, which I don't want to go to right this second. And you can see that very first batch of martyrs served up. And they're mad. Because, unfortunately, they didn't listen, and we know that they're going to go into this, but hopefully we left enough seeds, and at some point, Moses and Elijah are going to be hailed by the coming temple. And, by the way, there is a completed temple over in Brazil. I don't know if you know that or not. You should probably go check into that, because there's one there, and one wonders, is it possible for them to pull that thing apart? Air transport the pieces over to the Temple Mount and reconstruct it? That is a question. Because we know that in Revelation 11, and not everything in the Bible is in order. Some is and some isn't. Some is our vignettes. And then you have to start paying attention to each verse within each chapter to figure out where it plugs in to the Bible to get your order. Because like everything else in the Bible, the precepts can be all here, there, and everywhere. So there is some semblance of order, but you got to carefully divide scripture and pay attention to the vignettes. Well, anyhow, in Revelation 11, we know that temple heralds the two witnesses. And they'll be witnessing to people, and there will be that first batch of people that come to Christ, but under the most of not good circumstances. This movie, as well as Katy Perry, Flower Mountain Queen, pagan goddess, trippy trip trip, they are telling you their plans in fictional settings in these fables, and you better pay attention. And it is my desire that as many people as possible get into the ark now, but that you will run to Christ, and you can read about your own forthcoming deaths if you don't get into Christ now in Revelation 6 under the fifth seal. And so we're moving along towards that, and it very well could be this year for all the reasons I've already stated in this and the previous video. But anyhow, this is a weird movie. And let me show you Midsommar, Deep or Dumb. And he's got all kinds of advertising in here, which I'm going to spare you from. Notice who they make the villain. Christian.
Back to the show. All right, let's dive into a recap. MidSommar introduces us to 20-something Dani.
Oh, let me warn you. If you have kids in the room, you might want to get them out and you might want to put your earbuds in. It's going to get weird quick. And I don't watch this kind of filth. That's why I'm trying to deal with these trailers.
And her douchey boyfriend, Christian, who's about to dump her. But when Dani's sister kills herself and her parents, Christian can't exactly peace out. Motivated by guilt, he unenthusiastically invites her to tag along with him and his anthropology grad school bros on a trip to Sweden for a special once every 96 years MidSommar festival. They arrive at an idyllic Swedish commune and sh** almost immediately gets weird. Two old people jump off a cliff in a harakiri-esque ritual.
If you didn't know, here in this video, let me pull the page down. Jeff Sensor did a short little video on the Texas Lieutenant Governor Dan Patrick. Grandparents should sacrifice themselves, their lives, to save America.
Take this up, but they can hear Lieutenant Governor Dan Patrick on with the Muppet here. Tucker Carlson making his serious face that he likes to make at the camera. And, well, let me just play it for you. Listen in.
What's happening to this country? And, you know, Tucker, no one reached out to me and said, as a senior citizen, are you willing to take a chance on your survival in exchange for keeping the America that all America loves for your children and grandchildren? And if that's the exchange, I'm all in. And that doesn't make me noble or brave or anything like that. I just think there are lots of grandparents out there in this country like me. I have six grandchildren. That what we all care about and what we love more than anything are those children. And I want to, you know, live smart and see through this, but I don't want the whole country to be sacrificed. And that's what I see. I've talked to hundreds of people, Tucker, and just in the last week, and making calls all the time. And everyone says pretty much the same thing, that we can't lose our whole country. We're having an economic collapse. I'm also a small businessman. I understand it. And I talk with business people all the time, Tucker. And my heart is lifted tonight by what I heard the president say, because we can do more than, you know, one thing at a time. We can.
You can give up your life as if Dan Patrick here, fake name, of course. His real name is Goeb. And as if he's going to give up his life to save America. But this is a very interesting narrative that's coming out of this, because of course it does fit directly into Agenda 21.
Yep.
Euthanasia.
Yep.
And people sacrificing themselves at a certain age. Something you've seen played out a lot in the movies, most recently with the film Midsommar by Ari Aster. Mm-hmm. People. I mean, could you just imagine if they start asking old people to off themselves to save the economy? How far will it go, and how quickly will it go? And it's the left-right game, so, you know, people seem to think, you know, there's a, you know, oh, Fox News is better than CNN, and maybe marginally. But it's the same monster, basically, right? And it's either one way or the other way, they'll get what they want to get. So there's a very interesting angle to this whole coronavirus, in which, you know, in its early stages, it has been targeting the elderly. And now you're getting major league politicians saying, you know what, maybe we should all just give up our lives to keep the economy alive. Okay, after you, Mr. Yeah. Patrick.
Yep,
you
we'll go first.
We'll see you take the cyanide pill first. I mean, it's first. Just nuts what's going on. It is absolutely nuts. The worst part of it is... you will never, ever, ever find the solution or the people that will bring a solution that would help us all. You will never find that on the television. You will only find this type of programming, and it doesn't matter if you're on the left or the right, you are in their world, and they're yep. going to program people.
Yep.
So I'll play this part again here.
For the theme that we're trying to develop with a Midsommar movie, if you also cross-reference Katy Perry, I don't know how far I'm going to have to go down here. She has a picture on here somewhere, if I can find it, recently. That is not it. And she's drinking this weird green, supposedly celery drink. And it really, oh, good Lord. And she might have to look in here. It's kind of suggestive of that whole Soylent Green thing. You know the truth. Okay. See, these people are gaslighting you and messing with you. That's just stupid. Oh, yep. Yeah, the red and the blue. Now I gotta find this picture. Oh, brother. She does that idol show, whatever. Idol. She's drinking this green celery drink. And then there is a big, huge ad for Tomfoolery, which I guess is the name, either a meme that she did or the name. I'm not quite sure.
We are in the men's restroom. Welcome to.
It's either a meme or it is a line that she's produced of this beverage. Now I can't find it. How many things did she load on here? Good grief. Anyhow, tomfoolery, which is a way of saying joshing, joking, hoax. Is a way of them kind of gaslighting. What is she wearing? Okay. It must be way finding another spot rather than looking. Oh, okay, I'm getting close. I don't want to talk about the pineapple right now, but there is a theme with the water. Yay, I found it. So they couch everything in this double language. There's the surface. Oh, you know, Katie's made a line of tomfoolery health products, and it's the celery juice or whatever. She wants everybody to be healthy, and she's holding the lemon because that's vitamin C, and, you know, the whole deadly, everybody's going to die from spiky ball syndrome. But really, when you look just a layer beneath the surface, this is to cause you to think, oh, Soylent Green, as they're flagging out messages. That's at least my conjecture on it. And then the fact that it's called tomfoolery is just a way of saying trickery. Well, they push the rainbow agenda. And there's a lot of celebrities that are basically going to their underground bunkers is the word on the street. And I don't doubt it in the slightest. They're all being weird on their Twitters is the short takeaway. But anyhow, let's go back. Keeping in mind the headdress, the Mother Earth thing, her outfit, her song, her paganistic witchcraft proclivities, and how it matches up to this horrible film. And it's going to get really, that's not it, sorry. And it's going to get weird soon. This girl just walked up and she sees these old people taking a dive. And this is essentially what they want you to do. They're just seeding it into you with these films and making you think, oh, this is a good thing. And then somewhere too, there is an Agenda 21 commercial, really creepy, where all these old people are like, we decided to make a sacrifice for our family. And so it's like voluntary euthanasia. Like, you're the first to go. So it's going to get weird.
They arrive at an idyllic Swedish commune, and sh** almost immediately gets weird. Two old people jump off a cliff in a harakiri-esque ritual, this chick puts a pube in Christian's pie, and people dance and moan while tripping balls.
I don't know what that
These
means.
British people are reasonably like, wear out, and promptly disappear.
Has anyone seen Connie?
Things get progressively creepier, and the grad school bros are subsequently killed one by one in creatively horrifying fashion. But things are going comparatively better for Dani, who wins an all-girls stone dance competition, gets crowned May Queen, and is celebrated by the whole community. Then Christian gets roped into a weird sex ritual that Dani sees through a keyhole, but she doesn't have long to mope because there's about to be a cool human sacrifice, and she gets to select the ninth person to be set on fire.
Patiently wait your verdict.
She picks, you guessed it, Christian. Dani smiles as he and his fellow sacrificial lamb humans burn. The end. To figure out if this film is deep or not, we first have to decipher Astor's bloody depiction of a Midsummer festival. It's important to note that this film is not overly concerned with total anthropological fidelity. Midsummer, though an iconic Swedish holiday, is not a bloodbath where grandpas jump off cliffs or hapless foreigners are put in funny hats and burned to a crisp.
Well, says you, these were paganistic rituals that were done by witches. That's your bottom of your barrel, most basic, no-duh ritual sacrifice for their gods. So I totally disagree with you.
According to Poe Tidholm, author of the book Celebrating the Swedish Way, Midsummer is all about celebrating summer, eating herring, drinking aquavit, and staying up late. It is a light and happy tradition. He notes that it is held to welcome summertime and the season of fertility, and involves dancing around maypole.
Hold on. Fertility gods, fertility rituals, fertility rites, all that kind of stuff. That is the stuff that Yahweh said not to do. He tries to paint it as the most simplistic little thing ever, but it's totally not.
Decorating everything with ferns and plants, and visiting holy springs. As for that death...
Where we'll show you a much more truthful representation, and the person is not a Christian that's speaking either, I'm almost certain. And there's a lot of gaslighting going on here. They speak out of both sides of their mouth.
Not even in ancient times.
What?
And what about the weird sex stuff? That was completely the twisted brainchild of Astor. However, baby making is a big part of Midsummer, which is why a lot of Swedes are born a square 9 months after the sexy solstice. Cool. And about those psychedelic...
Oh, you know what? That painting on the face should completely remind you of the weirdness of the Druid pagan festivals. No, no. That John MacArthur, who's a Mason. No, he's a Christian. No, he's a Mason. He's one of them. Has their children do in their creepy festivals. That face painting is 100% a part of that. And, you can look through my videos for that, or I'll try to remember to put a link in for you.
Cool. And about those psychedelics, apparently celebrating Swedes are far more likely to get boozy than they are to trip balls.
Not that mean.
Duly noted. But don't go thinking Astor made up everything during a particularly industrious acid trip. Dude did his homework, spending months researching and eventually drawing from Swedish traditions and folklore, as well as Norse mythology. What? Imagery is consistent with real Swedish Midsummer celebrations, complete with a maypole. Similarly, the somewhat creepy paintings on the barn walls are also true to real agrarian Swedish society. People really do eat herring and wear flower wreaths. Astor also plucked other religious traditions, like the blessing of the crops, from a famous 19th century anthropological study by James George Fraser. These lighter details, all faithful to Swedish culture, are complicated by the film's darker turns, but we'll get to that later. Astor even went so far as to learn the Scandinavian runic alphabet, which was used to write Germanic languages in northwestern Europe before the adaptation of the Latin alphabet. He told...
Oh, by the way, Michael W. Smith has an album cover where he's being weird. How is he being weird? Well, here's the cover, and it's Christmas time. Michael W. Smith, go back. I have a laptop with one of those touchy pads. And he's, people far smarter than myself that know about this stuff have discussed that his name is spelled backwards. Anytime you see something that's backwards or upside down, that's kind of the whole Crowleyan, satanic, Luciferian thing where everything in their world is flipped upside down. And and the fact that he's holding his arms like that is really weird. Significant and satanic circles. They didn't like that, and I wouldn't either. That is weird. And then they also talked about how he uses that same, I guess they're pronouncing it, runic alphabet in the modern day, related to occult practices and witchcraft. Same thing as Satanism. Same thing as Masonry. Same thing as Kabbalah. Same thing as many false religions. And the chair that they have him standing on is comprised of the same formation people have noted. The word runic means secret. Right. The deeper things of Satan, right? There are several variations of the runic alphabet, but in researching, I found that the three more versions, which were dominated by the occult world, all have the identical T and M that you see on the back of Michael W. Smith's album. So that one and that one. And then he proves it. Schemes of Satan. So the church that you think is the church coming through your TV is not the church. They're the fakes. But they sound really good when they sing Christian music. It's all a farce. And he ain't forming. He is forming a runic T with his body. And he is. Yeah. Going so far as to lower his head to round off the top of the T. And is standing on top of a chair which forms a runic M. That is pretty shocking stuff. This is a Christian guy, right? 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 No. No, you're just being seated with nonsense, and this is how they worship their spirit god, their holy serpent god who gives them millions of dollars. You shouldn't be making millions of dollars as a servant of Christ, whether you're a musician or an author or a speaker or a pastor or whatever, and yet, in society, we have accepted this phenomena as normal. That's not normal. Now, let's just say that you end up getting all this money. You better hope you're giving most of it away. But anyhow, much more can be said about that. So this is a pretty interesting article. Oh, look at that. In this post, this occult expert says that the Smith is making the sign of T-Y-R, the sky god, who, according to Norse mythology, more paganism, sacrificed his hand to the furnace wolf in order to save others. Creepy. It's also a warrior symbol of great courage and overcoming death. And he's standing on an M, which is the rune for, mankind. I don't see that as sinister, but make what you will of it. The occult person says sinister. Well, that is all very subjective, isn't it, my little friend? Now, when you say his choice of room signifies the sky god and that this god of the world is being placed above mankind, that is very significant to me as a student of the Bible. The ancient manuscripts from which make up the Bible refer to Lucifer, yes, as the prince of the power of the air, the ether, for now, for the 6,000 years. Oh, by the way, when that 6,000th year passes and you have the Feast of Atonement fulfilled and what the Gentiles will term the second coming of Christ, that's with the great trumpet, and that's kind of the end now of the curse. And then you have some things happen, but basically Christ then brings that seventh day, 1,000 years of peace and prosperity, bringing the world from 6,000 to the 7,000th year, and then end. And some other things happen, and then you have eternity, which is like the eighth day. Eight is the day, new beginnings. Noah was one of eight new beginnings. There's so much that could be said about that, but I will spare you. So that looks actually like a really good article, but I don't want to get into all of that. I want to go back.
Argra clothing is decorated in specifically chosen runic symbols and in different hieroglyphic language they invented specifically for the film. A notable example comes when Christian dons a white robe before entering the world's weirdest fertility ceremony. The robe is decorated with the upwards arrow Tiwaz symbol, associated with the Nordic god Tyr, who represents bravery, masculine energy, and virility. Fittingly, Tyr sacrifices his hand to save the world, which is appropriate for a dude who's about to be, well, sacrificed. Dani, in contrast, has two runes on her dress that showcase her character's duality, an R-shaped Rytho, which symbolizes journey, and an hourglass-shaped Thaugaz rune, which could mean new beginning or loss of hope. Both symbols are up for interpretation, but each feel relevant to Dani's journey. As far as the death stuff goes, Aster was likely inspired by long-debated Viking mythology and folklore. Certain written and visual accounts from the prehistoric Viking period depict sacrifices of horses, dogs, birds, and yes, humans, which apparently occurred every 9 years. These accounts have been disputed by scholars, but they pretty much agree that if human beings were sacrificed, it probably happened before 1050 AD. So, regardless, some creative liberties are being taken.
Whatever.
Other striking moments are also infused with elements of Norse mythology. For instance, Christian is put inside a bear carcass before being burned alive. Bears are significant in Norse mythology. Viking men donned bear skins before battle, and some even believe that the skins protected them from fire. Perhaps even more grotesque is the fate of Simon, the British guy who Christian finds splayed open, his lungs somehow still breathing. This gruesome sight is a reenactment of the Blood Eagle, a Viking torture ritual that involves inside-outing a dude. The Blood Eagle was first documented in 865, but scholars are unsure whether it's possible, and...
Okay. So I know this symbol. There are over Adam Cohen, Jeremiah Cohen's channel. Sorry, Jeremiah Cohen's channel. Talk about these different celebrities doing these same postures all the time. Postures, symbols, so on and so forth. And instead of it being two flowers over the eye, they do the one eye with a flower. They do it all the time. So there's probably a lot to say about that. But, you know, Mother Earth, paganism, sacrificing those that are non-essential. They want to become gods on earth. They're flagging you out. What's going to happen? I hope you're watching. She's doing it. I mean, they do it all the time. Trying to find the ones where they put it over their eye. Reminds me also of that same flower headdress weird thing. These people must be involved in some really freaky rituals. That's just not cool. Rainbow Mafia. She's wearing a flower headdress or whatever you want to call it. Sometimes you got to put in just exactly the perfect right keyword. That's weird. Oh, I don't like that. That's weird. That's gross. There's a lot more of them. You just kind of got to look around for them. She's doing it. Apparently they turn everything into some type of witchcraft or occultism, ironically.
None have exactly volunteered to be the guinea pig. Then there are the Harga love rituals, some of which bear resemblance to reality. For instance, we see the Harga young women picking different types of flowers. In real life, they would pick 7 different kinds of flowers and put them under their pillow to conjure dreams of their future mate. Yes. Instead, Christian seducer Maya places a carved love rune under his bed. In a more shocking moment, Christian discovers a pubic hair in his pie. A loving way, the point is that Aster had fun combining truth and fiction, old and new, mythology and history, to build his creepy haven of cell phone-free agrarian life where ritualized human sacrifice is as normal as sourdough bread.
As normal as sourdough bread. Oh no, where are they taking him?
That's certainly not a criticism. If every horror film was confined to reality, the genre would be pretty boring. But in using this potpourri of references, is Aster trying to make a deeper point? Let's look at the 2 very different ways the film's outsider characters react to these rituals. We'll start with Dani, who despite the demented arseny that's going down, ends the film with a smile. What are we supposed to make of this? Has Dani become evil, or is there something more to it? We think so, and her character arc proves it. Dani begins the film pretty firmly ensconced in a cold, alienating, secular society filled with icy, lonely city streets. The colors are muted, and we get the sense that this is not a happy world. After losing her entire family, nobody really comforts Dani, and her shitty boyfriend only stays with her to seem like a good guy. Her world feels pretty absent of community and emotional support. She's shown alone in her house, with phone calls providing much of her communication with the outside world. Her detachment is apparent in her first phone call with Christian. The camera is set squarely on her face, without a single cut to him, implying that she's talking to somebody who isn't fully present.
I'm very lucky to have you.
Several other conversations are shown in mirrors, which could imply that people aren't really connecting and are only seeing each other's superficial public face. Her boyfriend is constantly trying to get away from her.
I was just gonna go to that party for 45.
Forgets her birthday, and pressures her to take hallucinogens despite her recurring panic attacks. Early on, their Swedish friend Pelle tells her that, despite being orphaned as a child,
I have always felt held by a family. A real family. Which everyone deserves. And you deserve.
It's clear what she's lacking. Love, empathy, and community. And that's exactly what she finds when she encounters the Harga people. Now, although she spends the first half of the film extremely wary and frightened of them, she's eventually seduced by the warmth of their community. Plus drugs. The Harga even seem to move in tandem, as if they're all dancing to the same piece of choreography. They behave like different parts of the same organism. The idea of shared catharsis, both in pain and pleasure, is present throughout the film. When this old man survives his leap off a cliff, the rest of the tribe moan in unison, as if experiencing a collective pain. This is repeated in the final ritual sacrifice, and every community, as Aster puts it, their language is empathy. At first, Danny's intimidated by their sense of unity, feeling too scared to join the ritual dancing.
You guys should join.
Oh no, I'm too scared.
However, she does appear to be struck by the connectedness of the people, staring closely during ceremonies. After the horrific sacrifice scene, Dani is visibly stunned and devastated, but she listens attentively as the elder woman explains,
"We view life as a circle, a recycle."
As someone who has recently lost her whole family, the idea of life being a circle of rebirth has to be attractive. We see Dani become increasingly more immersed in the Harga culture, as she starts to find the cult, community she craved. Most basically, this is shown in her costume, which transforms from her dark real-world clothing to an apron and eventually a full dress and flower wreath before the maypole dance. Here, she takes more hallucinogens, but this time in a ritualized motion, sharing the experience first with one Harga girl and then with the entire circle of them. Though she's slightly off rhythm, she can't avoid being led into the dance,
no.
And the dizzying experience
no.
is the first time we see her truly smile. She's finally moving as part of the singular Harga organism. But the most important moment of the film happens after she sees Christian having sex with rando Swedish girl. She bursts into uncontrollable tears, echoing the way she cried after learning about her family's death. Except this time, she's surrounded by a group of Harga women who cry in tandem with her, as if sharing her emotional load and completely empathizing with her pain. Interestingly, Dani's increased inculcation into the cult is mirrored by her increased immersion into nature. This begins psychedelically when she hallucinates her hands growing grass and then her feet turning into grass. Over the course of her May Queen rulership, she becomes covered with more and more flowers to the point of absurdity. By the end, she has almost entirely disappeared into a gown and crown of bright blossoms, symbolizing her surrender to nature and this agrarian society. We see this new fidelity to the Harga society when she picks Christian rather than a Harga to be the ninth sacrifice. As she watches the burning, she experiences pain, but like the Harga, also experiences joy. She's watching the vestiges of her former life crumble and can't help but smile, as she is free to start anew in a community where she can belong and be seen. It's creepy as hell, but makes for pretty great cinema. But if you're not interested in joining a community of happy inbred blonde people, there's another option. Enter Christian and the Dude Bros. They approach the Harga people with the condescending distance of anthropology students working on a thesis, sneaking into temples to take photos of secret religious texts, or watching the rituals as if surveilling animals at a zoo. The crazier the animals act, the better a peer-reviewed paper they'll have. Meanwhile, Mark, the unabashed fool, is more preoccupied with banging Swedish chicks and could care less about their beliefs, as demonstrated when he pees on a sacred tree and can't comprehend their reactions.
I just had to pee.
In general, they approach the Harga culture with the same detached shock and intrigue as us, an audience so alienated from the value of ancient rituals that we're willing to buy into the idea that they could be this horrific, or at least buy in enough for it to effectively scare us. So what is Astor doing here? The way we see it, the film is constantly playing into and subverting our modern secular aversion to mystical traditions. Religious worship has become increasingly alien to many of us, leading theologian David Bentley Hart to write that our religion is one of very comfortable nihilism. We tend to see ritual acts as primitive and potentially barbaric.
Yeah.
But this film's particular boogeyman takes the form of very religious Swedes rather than a sadistic serial killer or a shape-shifting clown speaks volumes about our society's fear and aversion to ritual.
At the same time,
Astor depicts the Harga clan as the precise answer to everything wrong with Dani's life. She's offered complete acceptance, genuine reciprocity, and total empathy. Thus, Midsommar is a shocking reassertion of the value of ritual. No matter how irrational these acts may seem, they have a very rational purpose.
Yeah, so you can see it for yourself. These headdresses of flowers have a paganistic root. And at the heart of it, even if those people deny it, I mean, the ninth command, hello, people lie all the time. There remains a form of paganism with regard to earth worship, and people are all going to be taxed into oblivion. The flower crown, Mother Earth. There's a reason why they dress these people up in these headdresses of naturistic stuff. And then add the technology into it, and I think that you've got something coming of their own creation of a god combined with AI. And this is a way, look, see, flower goddess crown. And there's probably a lot going on with the flower over the eyeball. But they're seeing everything through the eyes of this rebirth of nature and taking over the world. And there's a reason why they have them in this type of garb and attire. This stuff goes somewhere. It doesn't stay static. These people do believe themselves to be gods. And she did it just a ton of stuff with, you know, the celebration of the flowers. Now that's not on her head, but that's fine. I don't really care. Yeah, look at that halo goddess. This is patriarchal male religion, aka, that's weird. Jesus, Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob, the God of them. And This is about the celebration of the goddess. And they're actually worshiping her in this, Beyonce. And she has a crown. Whether it's a crown of, you know, this, that, or the other, I could really care less. But it is these celebrity millionaire or billionaire witches. Look, now they have flowers in their mouth, just like that guy that was dying. So let's do one last video so that you really understand that they're telling you, flagging it out to you, what their plans are for those who will be a part of that.
Swedish festival.
This is weird.
Midsommar is a horror movie about a Swedish festival gone very, very wrong. The film was written and directed by Ari Aster, the man behind 2018's Hereditary. This follow-up is equally disturbing and just as baffling. Here are all of the symbols and hidden references in the movie, and how they relate to its shocking ending. Warning, spoilers ahead. First of all, while Midsommar quickly turns into a cultish nightmare, the movie is ultimately about the end of a relationship between the two main characters, Dani and Christian. Ari Aster was recovering.
I would also tell you, too, that while they're saying that it's these two characters ending their relationship, there is a deeper meaning of the world going by way of the goddess Paganistic, sympathy for Mother Earth, taxing you into oblivion. And then they apparently step him in a bear and light him on fire. Now, you would also connect, I think, this whole issue of the stock market that has these meanings of whether it's a good time or bad time to be in the market, I guess, with the bull or the bear. And that's also represented in your Tom Hanks, a minute and a half video, Talking Heads, Letting the Days Go By, where there's also the representation of those two animals, slavery, their little puppets underneath them with getting away with it. But anyhow, so the earth is breaking up with the Christians. The pagans are breaking up with the Christians is kind of the deeper meaning of what's going on here with this.
Dani and Christian. Ari Aster was recovering from a breakup of his own while he was developing the film, and that experience influenced his writing of the characters, in particular, Dani. He was also inspired by romantic films like 1973's Scenes from a Marriage and 1981's Modern Romance.
I don't think that we should go out anymore.
As for his horror influences, there's a clear reference to The Shining in this overhead shot of The Journey. Early in the movie, the paintings on the walls of the apartments hint toward the ending of the film and the very messy breakup we witness. In Christian's apartment, we see a painting by Brooklyn-based artist Mu Pan. The work is part of a series called Dino Assholes, a title that seems very appropriate for Christian's character, given his callous treatment of Dani. Also visible is this work by Swedish artist John Bauer. It depicts a little girl in a crown facing a large bear. This painting directly alludes to the movie's ending, when Christian is placed inside a bear carcass and set on fire. Dani watches him burn while wearing a crown of flowers. Later, in Siv's house, Christian also sees an image on the wall of a bear being burned alive, further foreshadowing his untimely death.
So we're just gonna ignore the bear then?
It's a bear.
Aster compared the sacrificial burning of the temple to the burning of a box of an ex's personal items as a sort of catharsis post-breakup. Only, of course, far more extreme. The sacrificial burning at the end also calls back the ending of The Wicker Man, in which the outsider main character is placed in a wooden statue and set afire. Aster and his team spent months researching Scandinavian and Germanic folklore, and scattered Easter eggs throughout the film, which also hint at the culmination of Dani and Christian's relationship, major plot points, and other characters' deaths. One of the most important set pieces, the bunkhouse, exemplifies this attention to detail. The inner walls are covered in elaborate murals painted by artist Ragnar Persson and based on medieval art. If you look closely, these images actually reveal much of the plot. Basically, the bunkhouse fulfills the same function as the dollhouse did in Hereditary, illustrating much of the story before it actually happens. For example, above one of the beds, we see an illustration of two people having sex, surrounded by onlookers. This clearly refers to the mating ritual Christian is later lured into to impregnate Maya. This scene is also hinted at when the boys are eating earlier in the film and discussing all of the Swedish girls they plan on impregnating during the trip. Another illustration shows people cutting their hands as a sacrifice. Soon after, we see the old couple cut their palms atop the cliff.
Okay, spirit cooking. Who remembers the spirit cooking? Cooking up spirits. Slicing your hand. And Podesta. Right? These people love witchcraft. Cool. They love it. That is so disgusting. Okay, and then I guess John Podesta outed the whole thing of important but overlooked global goal number 14. We must protect, in quotes, our oceans and life as they sustain. And there that is. So, of course, they say everything, you know, so it sounds all nicey-nice on the onset, but in all reality, this is the total putting the earth above everything else, they say, and Romans 1 coming into play. So sustainable development goals. So see, your whole world is set up as being this witchcraft, paganistic, seeking godhood for themselves, society of people in every area of influence, and then they go into film too, and they reflect their same values in and through their work, through the movies. And everywhere else. And this is the plans they have for you. And the old people need to die. You need to die. And then the Christians need to die. If God would allow that. And but remember, there is a rescue coming. Revelation 12:5. That Harpazo is coming. And much more could be said. Let's keep going here.
Right before they jump to their deaths. Also covering the walls are many runes. An ancient language that features heavily throughout the film. At one point, the characters refer to the runes as Elder Futhark and Younger Futhark, two evolutions of the same system of language. Looking at the meanings of some of these symbols, we can try to piece together why Astor chose them in certain parts of the movie. He assigned each character a rune, which we can see clearly on their robes. Dani has an R rune on her dress, which symbolizes a ride or a journey. This likely refers to her own journey of finally coming to terms with the truth about her relationship. The hourglass-shaped rune next to it symbolizes day, or an awakening. This likely refers to Danny's breakthrough about Christian.
Okay, and also this word of awakening in the scripture, when you go get into Amos, and you pay attention to Christ's words, especially in the Hebrew, and you realize that when God talks about this, you know, oh, what do you see, Amos? This fig poker pricker. Amos says, I see a basket of summer fruit. And then the Lord cryptically says in Amos 8:1 and I think 2, he says, the end of Israel has come upon my people. And when you really dig into all that through the original language of the Hebrew, you really come to understand. It's pretty interesting. Basically, in a nutshell, I'll just translate it for you. I've been studying this pretty heavily. He's talking about bad figs that are talked about in Revelation. No, in Jeremiah, one of the chapters in Jeremiah. I don't recall which one right this second. But he's having a conversation with Jeremiah, the Lord. And the Lord says that there are good figs and bad figs. And so there's also this connotation with Amos. He's having this conversation with Amos. And God is saying that when you see this basket of the harvest of those who are awake, and he's not just talking about agricultural food, but rather fruit in the Bible is, you know, consequence, idea, people, this group of people that come about in this end times application together in one as the bad fruit, those who awaken. You know, you start thinking about those things and you start realizing this idea that this awakening is this new age transhumanist, you know, same verse, same as the first back in in Genesis 3 all over again. And that is this whole global movement of these bad figs moving society into this acquisition of this false godhood when everything's said and done. And so God is essentially saying, when everything's said and done, that as you see this global movement of people moving society towards this awakening, that is a satanic awakening, and they're not getting into Christ, they're going the other direction into godhood, basically wanting to bite into that apple or pomegranate or whatever it was, once again, but through technology and witchcraft, this return to paganism, so on and so forth, society just going belly up. You know that the
moment of clarity for her. Dani's character also experiences a slow reawakening throughout the festival. The first sign of her rebirth is when she wakes up from her nap and suddenly her skin appears golden and almost glittery. Meanwhile, Christian's robe has an up arrow rune, which could reference either the male symbol or a willingness to self-sacrifice, ironically a quality he does not have. The first bloody sacrifice we witness is that of two senior members of the community who throw themselves off a cliff. This tradition is called Atestupa. It's based off of Nordic legends in which people would commit ritual suicide when they grew too old to care for themselves any longer. When the man and woman rub their bloody hands on the runestones, the two symbols that appear are the R from Dani's robe and the up arrow from Christian's robe. The shape of the dining table is also significant. This rune symbolizes tradition, the passing down of rituals and rites. If you look closely at the sun-like entrance to the village, you'll see the same shape but upside down. The X inside the sacred temple can mean gift, which makes sense as the community is planning on gifting 9 souls to the gods.
Gods.
Beyond the bunkhouse murals, there's a tapestry in the open field that also foretells parts of the plot. It depicts a bizarre love story in which a girl puts her menstrual blood and pubic hair in a boy's food and drink to make him fall in love with her.
Ew.
This is exactly what Maya does to Christian. You can see here that his drink is darker than the others,
ew,
with a reddish tint. And he pulls a pubic hair out of his mouth after taking a bite of the pie. While the most horrific events in the film are fictitious, the holiday and many of its...
Are fictitious? How do you know? This is what these Masons do behind closed doors. They worship spirits by gifting them blood. Blood of animals, their own blood, other people's blood. And this is how they stay in the multi-million dollar, you know, position that they're in. And they have to do these things in order to stay in Satan's good graces, if that even makes sense.
Rituals are very real. MidSommar is an annual event that takes place in mid-June, around the summer solstice. It's popular across the globe, particularly in Scandinavia. And it's even depicted briefly in the Disney movie Frozen. MidSommar was initially a pagan holiday, but it eventually merged with the Christian feast day of St. John the Baptist.
The feast day of St. John the Baptist. I'm not familiar with that feast day. What is she even talking about?
A celebration of the prophet's birth. Indeed,
no.
There are several references to John the Baptist in the film. Pell tells Dani that the festival lasts 9 days, and that the event is special because it only occurs every 90 years. In the Bible, the Virgin Mary stayed with John the Baptist's mother, Elizabeth, for 90 days before Elizabeth gave birth. Then, when they get to the field outside the village, Ingemar wishes Pell a happy St. John's in Swedish. One of the flowers that covers the village...
Okay, one thing that's pretty significant about John the Baptist, let's see, what could that be? Let's see. They took his head. Beheadings. Noah hide. You dig?
...is St. John's wort. It's customary to celebrate St. John's Day with bonfires, like the one that burned the sacrifices alive in the final scene.
Gross.
And with torches, like those that the villagers carry throughout the film. One of the key components of Midsommar is the maypole, which we see in the film covered in flowers and greenery for good luck.
Yeah.
The ritual in which the villagers dance around the maypole is based in a real-life Midsommar custom, one that revolves around procreation and fertility.
Yep.
So it makes sense that Christian's bizarre sex ritual is a major part of what comes next. The community makes way for new life by making a lot of bloody sacrifices.
Yeah.
Let's start with what happened to Josh. When he goes to bed on his last night, he's already set on sneaking into the barn to photograph the holy book. The camera lingers on his shoes as he pulls the blanket over his body. The shot of his sneakers may be referencing the mass suicide of the Heaven's Gate cult in 1997, when 39 cult members were found dead on their bunk beds, having taken a powerful sedative and covered themselves in purple sheets. As an anthropology student, Josh is obsessed with Northern European pagan traditions, to the extent where he's fully embraced this cult in Sweden. His ambition and academic passion is ultimately what brings his demise. In the barn, Josh is attacked by Ulf, the same man who got angry at Mark for peeing on the ancestral tree. The most disturbing part, Ulf is now wearing Mark's face. Later, we see the skin of Mark's face placed on a straw dummy and topped off with a jester's hat. This cruel fate is foreshadowed earlier in the movie.
And you know, they present this as the most normal thing in the world, like ordering a hamburger. I'd like a hamburger with onions and no cheese. You know, and you're just like this gross, disgusting, nasty, breaking the sixth command. This really upsets my stomach. And this is just the trailer for it, or just, you can't call it a trailer, but like an analyzation of it. But there is a deeper meaning here, which is why I'm putting up with it, because I don't like this stuff. But I'm telling you that they're flagging you out these warnings of what they're going to do. And the Lord is coming in rescue, but for the fake Christians and the unbelievers, they got plans for you, and they're telling you in this trash that they make money from, because this is how they do it.
What are they playing?
Skin the fool.
In retrospect, this bit of foreshadowing makes sense, as Mark pretty neatly fit the comedic archetype of the fool. An even greater horror is done to Simon, the Londoner who mysteriously disappeared without his fiancée, Connie. Christian stumbles on Simon tied face down in the chicken coop, with his back sliced open and liver and ribs exposed. As we look closer, we see that his lungs are moving, indicating that Simon is still alive. If you're wondering how anyone could come up with this stuff, it turns out Aster did months of research on Viking torture techniques. What Simon subjected to is right in line with the Blood Eagle method of execution by torture, a prolonged type of ritual killing detailed in Norse poetry. So why have such brutal Viking rituals survived in this insular community? And what does it all mean? To get an idea, we should look to Reuben, the so-called oracle in the community. As an elder in the village explains, Reuben was purposely inbred to serve as a conduit for the word of the gods. The boy is said to have unclouded judgment as a result of his condition and his pure blood. Towards the end of the movie, he's shown sitting on a seat covered in cotton, looking almost like he's sitting on a cloud. In Aster's words, Reuben embodies the political message of the film, which is perhaps partly critiquing the global rise of xenophobia and the return of the far right in Sweden. As Aster said in an interview, if you consider Swedish history, it is a very closed society, and what does that really mean? There are things happening in Sweden right now that are echoes of things that happened in the Second World War. Okay, now back to the ending of the film. It seems that the burning of the sacred temple was part of Pell's plan from the very beginning. One theory? While Dani's family seemed to die in a murder-suicide, what if it was actually a setup? Next to her parents' bed was a crown of flowers, and there are similar yellow flowers on their wallpaper too, a mysterious bit of foreshadowing. What if, say, Pell killed Dani's family to trigger the series of events that led her to the festival? He does emphasize that he was most looking forward to Dani coming along on the trip, more than anyone else. Whether or not Dani was chosen by Pell, there are some other hints that she was always a perfect candidate for May Queen. One is her birthday, which Pell is well aware coincides with the beginning of the festival. Dani's in her mid-20s. Which is significant because, as Pell explains, his community thinks of one's life in terms of seasons. The first 16 years of life are equivalent to one season, spring. Dani is midway through the next season, summer, so literally mid-summer. Regardless of the impetus for Dani's journey, the movie comes full tragic circle by the end, beginning with the deaths of her family and ending with the death of Christian. As Aster says, You start with the unfathomable, and you end with the unfathomable.